Good afternoon, and welcome to E-Rate, What's New for 2016. This is our E-Rate workshop for the upcoming funding year. I am Christa Burns. My title here at the Nebraska Library Commission is Library Development Consultant. But as one of my duties as a Library Development Consultant here is I am the State E-Rate Coordinator for Public Libraries here in Nebraska. So I am your person to go to for any questions, help you need with E-Rate. That's my job here to keep you on track and make sure that you all get your money. And my contact information is the end of the slides here, so you'll be able to get in touch with me there. For our workshop today, I have a mixture of things for new people about what is E-Rate, what's the basics of it, how it all works, and then a lot of the new things that have been coming out in the last couple of years as well with the modernization they've been doing to the E-Rate program. So for those of you who've done E-Rate in the past, this will be some refresher, but it doesn't help to be reminded of some things, of course, and you'll find out what things are coming up new. For people who are brand new to this program, have never done it before, this will be perfect for you as well, I hope, because you'll learn everything you need to know about the basic program itself and what things you need to pay attention to coming up this year. So let's get started. So what is E-Rate? E-Rate is a federal program that gives discounts to schools, libraries, and some other organizations. You get discounts on your telephone, which is your telecommunications, and your internet access, your monthly internet bills, and any sort of construction, wiring, networking, things like that for internet. The money for the program comes from the Universal Service Fee. This is a fee that comes up if you look at your phone bills or your internet bills. You'll find either that it'll potentially say Universal Service Fee. Sometimes it'll be abbreviated USF, and all those like 10 different taxes and fees we all pay. We all pay into it. The telecommunication companies, our service providers, our phone and internet service providers all pay into it as well. So all of that money goes into a big pot that is then the E-Rate program uses to spread it out among the schools and libraries to help them afford their phone and internet services. The FCC runs the program. They are the main ones that oversee all of it, so all the rules and everything come down from them. And they created this company when the program first started out in 1997, the Universal Service Administrative Company. This is an organization that runs E-Rate, is the program for schools and libraries. It's been given that nickname, E-Rate, as an education rate. There are also three other programs. There's one for healthcare facilities that they can get a discount for people who are in high-cost areas, so where internet or phone costs may be very expensive, like in Alaska or something, and for low-income people, there's a special program for that as well. So there's other discount programs that USAC runs. The one we're concerned about with is the one that's a schools and libraries division that they've put all of our school and the public libraries and schools all together in one group to handle our E-Rate. So as I said, the FCC sets the rules. So they put out what they call reports and orders every now and then, letting USAC know what they need to do to run the program, how they want the program to work. These things don't come out all that often over the whole lifetime of the program. Like I said, that started in 1996, 97. There's been five or six of them. But just in the last couple of years, they've gotten really quickly with releasing them. Two modernization reports and orders. And those are the actual titles of them, the E-Rate Modernization Report and Order. One was in July 2014 and one in December. And this is where all the changes that we've been talking about that we're talking about today come into play. Some of these changes actually went into effect last year with the 2015 funding year. Some of them are coming with the upcoming funding year, that's the 2016 year. So you'll see a few things from both coming up. Once the FCC says what they want to have done, then USAC has to figure out the actual procedures, and then you have the FCC approve them, and then it becomes part of the what we do when we do E-Rate. Now, who can apply for E-Rate? All libraries and library systems are eligible. In Nebraska, the real only criteria is that you must be eligible to receive LSTA funding, Library Service Technology Act funds. In Nebraska, that makes all public libraries eligible. So don't need to have received the actual funds. It's just that you are eligible for them. Also in Nebraska, all of our schools and school districts, and if there are any consortias where groups of schools or libraries may get together to purchase any services, any internet access or phone or anything, that would also be able, they would also be able to be eligible for E-Rate. Now, the first thing I always tell people when they're thinking about doing E-Rate is figure out how much of a discount you can get first to see if it's even going to be worth your while to participate in the program. It is a program that is an ongoing program that you have forms that you fill out throughout the year, so you are doing things at a certain time of year, doing different steps. So it might take some time and some work, but if you get a big discount, it may be worth all that effort. So to calculate your discount, you can get anywhere from 20 to 90% off of your costs. This is off of your telephone and your internet, the costs that are eligible. The discount is calculated using a combination of two things. First, you look at your school lunch program number. So this is the free and reduced lunches that the children in the schools where your library is located, how many of them are eligible. So for that, you look to see where physically is the library located, in what school district, and you look at the numbers for that school district. It's the numbers for the district as a whole, not just the school that's closest to you. So if you've got a elementary and middle and high school, all three of those together. You can't include pre-K numbers, so anyone who's in pre-K needs to make sure that if there are any of them, any of those children who are eligible, they are removed from the calculation. And something to be aware of here is this is the students that are eligible for the program, not necessarily the ones that apply and participate. Not all children who are eligible, not all of their families do participate. Sometimes the parents don't want to, don't think they need to. So it's not just who participates, it's the ones who are eligible for the program. And that will be a higher number than the ones that participate, which is good for you. The FCC chose this as the determination of how to divvy up the E-Rate funds. They needed something that was an indicator of poverty. And there are lots of different ways they can do that, and they just chose this one, as in, because if there are the more children that may be eligible for the school lunch program needing the free and reduced lunches, that may be an indicator of higher level of poverty in that area. They need more help with the schools and libraries, may need more help paying for their phone and their internet services. In addition to that, once you have that number, you find out if you're urban or rural based on what the U.S. Census says. Here in Nebraska, we're mostly rural, which is good because a lot of the discounts are higher once you're in a rural area. So to get this information, luckily for us here, the Department of Education here in Nebraska posts these numbers on their website. I've got a link there. Later on, I'll give you all the quick links to everything, so don't try and scribble them all down right now. You'll have these slides and actual links to everything later. So they post on their website a spreadsheet every year. Usually it's updated in December, so it should be coming out, the new one, very soon. And it tells you the number of children that are enrolled in the school and then the number of kids that are eligible for the free and reduced lunches. You do the calculations for that and you find out your percentage. Something nice they've added to the spreadsheet in the last couple of years, originally it wasn't there, is they first just had all the schools individually and you had to find them all and do a calculation yourself. They've added a third tab, a third sheet in the spreadsheet that is the district as a whole, so you can go and grab that yourself. They've done that extra math for you. However, do make sure you go back and check and make sure on the individual schools section if it says that pre-K is included, and if it does say that in your school they're counting the pre-K or that they may have, you'll need to call the school and double check and make sure and ask them, are any pre-K kids included in this? Because if they are, you won't be able to. You'll have to find out how many of them there are so you can remove them from the calculation. So once you have that information, you can then go onto the USAC website. They've set up a lookup tool to find out if you are considered urban or rural based on where you're counting. This is based on the 2010 census data. So according to the FCC, urban is areas with populations greater, equal to or greater than 25,000, and anything below that is rural. So as I said, most of Nebraska falls into rural. But you can double check that lookup tool to find out what you are. Once you have those two bits of information, your school lunch percentage and your urban or rural status, they have a discount matrix that tells you what kind of a discount you get. or how much of a discount you get. Now, you'll notice here there's two categories listed, Category 1 and Category 2, and I'll get into that in a second. That has to do with what kind of a discount, what kind of services you can get. But what you see here, if you have percentage of students eligible for the school lunch program, anywhere up to 49%, the rural areas receive a slightly higher discount. So it's good that we're a pretty rural state here in Nebraska. And you can just see here how much of a discount you would get up to the 90%. You notice in Category 2, and I'll get into explaining that, the highest you can get is 85%, not the 90% that you can get in Category 1. So this is how you figure out what how much of a discount you could possibly get. So definitely look at this first to find out if it's worth it for you. Most of the libraries in Nebraska get somewhere between 60 and 80% of a discount on their phone, telecommunications, and internet services. So for most of our libraries, it's a really good deal. So I definitely recommend taking a look at this and figuring out if it would work for you. The E-rate funding year itself runs from July 1st through June 30th of any year. So whenever you're thinking about applying for E-rate, you're thinking to the future. You're not thinking about what I'm paying this month or a project I did last year. You're thinking for the upcoming year in July 2016, that's what I'm applying for. So right now, the beginning of the process for the 2016 funding year is starting. People are submitting the first form in the process that I will explain in a bit. And what they're doing is thinking to next July in 2016, that's when I'll start receiving the discounts on the bills that are that I will be receiving that month through June of the 2017. There's, as you can see here, approximately $4 billion of money available, which is really good for us. They've upped the amount available for our different areas. They added some more money into the Category 2 services that they had in reserve. So there is quite a bit of money available here for the schools and libraries. And this is money that cannot be used for anything else. This is specifically for helping schools and libraries get discounts on these services. So if it's not used for this, and if there's, you know, the money isn't used, it isn't put into some other program or isn't put into defense or environment or something, it's just for this particular program. So I, you know, definitely want to go in there and get your monies. So that's how much of a discount you can get. What can you get a discount on? What is E-rateable, so to speak? Every year, the FCC posts an eligible services list. This is a list of all of the products and services and things that you can get a discount on through the E-rate program. There's a URL, pretty long URL there, that you can go to see the current list. So whenever you are applying for E-rate, make sure you look at the upcoming year's list. They do update it every year, so last year's list may have different things on it than this year's. They're always paying attention to new technologies coming out, new ways of accessing your internet and your telecommunications, new construction projects that might be going on. So they're always updating the list and making changes to it. So always make sure you're looking at the future one. When you go to that link, you will see all the previous year's lists if you want to. They are still up there for reference. People need to know what was eligible in a previous year. But make sure you look at the current one to see what is coming up that would be eligible. This is something that has been affected very, very much. This is the most effect has been on this eligible services list as far as this modernization goes. And I'll let you know now, as we're going through this presentation, anything in the green text that I've put in here is things that are are the new things, things that these two new modernization orders have changed in the program. So if you want to know what things are that way, that can give you a little indication of what's new as opposed to the way it's always been. Now, in 2014, this is one of the first things I want to do is FCC wanted to streamline the list. The list has gotten huge and unwieldy and just really too many different variations on what to do. In 2014, before they started this modernization, the list was 49 pages long. It was huge. It was a lot to go through. Over the years, it had just gotten every little permutation and variable of how someone could or couldn't apply for something was added to it, and it just got to be ridiculous. So they said, get it easier, make it easier for libraries to figure out what they can and can't get a discount on. So as of 2015 and 2016, the list is only 8 pages long. much more simple, short, sweet, to the point. Basically, this is what you can get. If it's not on here, it's not eligible. So they really simplified just all the wording that they just really didn't need all of that extra. In the eligible services list, the services are all divided in two different categories, Category 1 and Category 2. Previously, if anyone's in the program from before, this was your Priority 1 and Priority 2. Still pretty much the same services in those areas, but some things could be a little different, and they now just call them Category 1 and 2. The way to category one is all the services bringing your connectivity, your phone, your telecommunications to your library building. So your monthly phone bill, your monthly internet service bill, that is getting the connection to your building. Category two is once you've got that service, you then need to get it out to all of your devices, to all your computers, so your workstations. You'll need wiring and networks and servers and things like that, and routers to get it out to the computers in the library. And that's your Category 2 services. You kind of think of this as Category 1 is the walls of the library fall between Category 1 and 2. Category 1 is outside the walls, just getting the connection in. Category 2 is everything inside your walls. As I said, this has been one of the big changes, is the changes to the list. And FCC has decided to change their focus on what is going to be E-rate eligible. They have looked around and decided that, as many people have noticed, internet service and access to schools and libraries is not good enough as far as they're concerned. It needs to be faster. It needs to be broadband or fiber. It just needs to be better than what we're getting now. And they want to, as the classic phrase is, close the Wi-Fi gap to all of these schools and libraries as well. So there's a lot more that they want to go E-rate money into for broadband, providing broadband and internet access. In order to do that, one of the things they are doing is phasing down support for voice services. This is your telephone. excuse me. A lot of libraries in Nebraska have been using E-rate for, again, discount on their phone services, and that's great. And you still can for a while. It's a gradual phase down that I'm going to explain in just a second here. But in order to get the support they want to go to the internet and Wi-Fi and broadband, they need to change things around and eliminate some support to other services. So gradually, eventually, E-rate is going to be strictly for internet-related services and nothing related to your telephone. This actually worked. The first year they did this was last year, and they funded all applications. In 2014 and I think 2013, don't quote me on that, I can't remember that far back, but I know in 2014 they only were able to fund the Category 1 level of services, which then was Priority 1, your basic phone and your basic internet access. Anything in Category 2 was not funded at all. They ran out of money in 2014. They were unable, anyone who was doing wiring and construction and needed routers or anything like that, there was no money left over. They ran out because there's so much, all of it went into Category 1. In Category 15, they started just a gradually phasing out some of the support to voice services, and they were able to fund all applications. So, it's a good thing that it's working. Not all schools and libraries agree with this change from the FCC. This is true. Many school districts did contact the FCC and make their official comment to their modernization order, saying phone service is an essential service, telephone, fax, our 800 lines, whatever, and we need support for it to keep it going. And if we don't continue with the support, we could have to cut out other services, and that would be detrimental to our students and our users. FCC took that in consideration but said, sorry, we still are focusing on internet, so we are still going to continue with the phase down of the voice services. So this is something you will have to think about as you're doing E-rate, that is something you will gradually have less support for the voice, and you may need to switch over to getting more involved in doing internet if you have not been using E-rate for internet before. However, I do know that here in Nebraska, and this is a thing that is common across many rural states, many of our libraries receive their internet access for free or at a very, very steep discount from their local providers. They're doing a good deed serving the community and making sure the library has a good connection. And E-rate is pretty much a moot point for them. I don't know what the FCC knows or thinks about that, but it may not be something that you can then use to help make up for your loss of the discount for voice services. But do be aware of it, that it is coming, so that you can prepare your budgets and figure out what you can do to keep your library services going. So what is eligible in Category 1? Basically, anything that can get high-speed internet to your library building is eligible. This is not a complete list, but this is just some of the ways you can get internet. Your cable modem, DSL, fiber, your T1 lines, wireless services, all of these are eligible. I'll explain a bit about the fiber, lit and dark fiber. That is something I've been asked a lot. Lit fiber is the fiber lines that are already on and working and are you can get connected to. When they did this construction and first laid in these fiber lines, digging the trenches, putting them in the ground throughout your areas, they put in on purpose more fiber than was needed at the time. That was necessary. They knew there would be more demand coming in the future. So it was all laid in. Some of it was turned on, that's the lit. Some of it was left turned off, that's the dark fiber. If you can find a company in your area, whoever is in control of the dark fiber, and have it turned on, that cost of having it turned on and this then the service itself is you can get an E-rate discount on both of those things. So that's the difference between the lit and the dark. Lit is already existing and people are using it. Dark is something you'll need to have turned. Find out who owns it, who's in charge of it, and have it turned on. So this is the first thing that's eligible for E-rate is all of your getting your internet access to your library. So voice services are still eligible as of now. Any way that you get your phone, your telephone access, your local long distance, 800 service, voice over IP, POTS is plain old telephone service. It's an old phrase that was known by your satellite service. This would include your fax lines as well because they are done over your telephone lines. These are all still eligible at the moment. And here is you can see the explanation here of the phase down. They are gradually phasing out support for the anything related to voice services based on your discount percentage. So that calculation we did earlier for using the school lunch numbers and whether you're urban or rural. Starting with last year, 2015, they reduced it by 20%. And they will be reducing it 20% every year until we're down to zero. The end date will vary from library to library depending on where you started, of course. So, for example, if your discount calculation is 80%, then in 2015, your phone discount was only 60%, and in 2016 it'll be 40%. Your internet service stays the same, that stays at the full 80%, if that's your calculation. It's just the telephone service that goes down. So 40% still is a good deal, I think, on even for the upcoming year. So I definitely recommend continuing with doing your phone service if you've been doing it, because to get a discount as long as you can. It'll be 40% in 2016. 20% in 2017, and then it'll be gone because it won't be. You'll be down to zero. The highest discount ones will be done as of funding year 2019 is when they will have everything phased out completely. So just keep that in mind as you're thinking about your phone. Any questions about that yet? Any questions about your discount, getting it, what's eligible in your Category 1? You type into your questions section of your GoToWebinar interface, and I can see your questions over here. If you do have anything, type in at any time you want to. Don't wait for me to ask, and I will grab them as I see them come through. So that's our Category 1. Category 2. This is the services that are within the building, bringing the broadband into and throughout the library. So your routers and servers and wiring and cables, any construction related to that. This is now Category 2 is done in a different way to figure out how much money you can get for what your discount would be from E-rate. They do it based on a 5-year budget that I will explain in just a second here. This includes things like your internal connections, as I was saying, and basic maintenance of those connections. So if you have somebody comes in and does regular servicing of them, or you have repair work done or something, all that ongoing maintenance can be you can get a discount on through Category 2 as well. So this is all the eligible internal connection type things you can get. Your access points, your cables, your firewalls, routers, racks, the uninterruptible power supply, and any improvements and upgrades that need to be done to all of this. Software that is necessary to run these your broadband, that is eligible. Other kinds of software, like just your databases that you have access to, or your Microsoft Word, or things on your computers, those kind of software programs are not eligible. But software you need to keep your broadband going, that is eligible under the category too. Something new they've added is, this is a new way that you can get internet access. It's called Managed Internal Broadband Services, or Managed Wi-Fi. This is something that a third party can provide your internet service completely. If you don't have a staff person or on duty, or someone who you who knows how to handle this, or someone in you don't have an extra tech person that can do this, or you yourself don't know all the details, you don't want to have to deal with your ongoing internet access, this is something that someone from the outside can now come in and provide for you. They can run it all completely, keep track of it, manage it. All you do is pay them, and they keep track of everything, and is even as far as all the repairs and all. So look into this and see if there is some sort of a someone in your area that does this. You might be able to get internet or better internet for yourself this way. Something else that is eligible is your basic maintenance of your internal connections. This is any repairs, any updates, configurations, any tech support that you need to have done. We need to upgrade to the newest, you know, version of Windows or whatever to get connected to your internet. This is something that you can get a discount on as well. Okay, someone asks, am I right? You can't get maintenance for wiring, et cetera, if you're not getting internet service. Actually, that's not true anymore. Basic maintenance is separate from the internet. You can just apply for basic maintenance if you want to. It's a separate category now in your forms when you're applying for that. But in order to get this, what you do need is you do have to have a contract of some sort with someone to do this. So you'd have to arrange ahead of time that this is either with your internet provider or with some other person who's your local tech person in town, that they are going to be the person who you contract with to do any of this work whenever it might need to be done. If they come in regularly and fix things and update things for you, if they have to come in and fix something, if there's, you know, wiring gets chewed through in the walls by a squirrel or something, you can have them come in to do that. However, you only get a discount in this case on the actual work they perform. So, for example, if you have a contract for you, pay them $20 a month to be on call for you, you don't get a discount on the $20 a month you pay, but when they do have to come in because something needs to be updated or something needs to be repaired, that particular work order, that you can get a discount on that. So you would have to pay just monthly, but not you can then apply after they've done the work to get a reimbursement on the work they actually had to do for you. Oops. And the last thing that is eligible for E-rate, and this could fall into either category one or two, this is all those extra fees, your taxes and surcharges and anything else, all those extra fees and taxes that are on the end of your bills. Make sure you include those when you do request your discounts, because those are all eligible as well. Any training you have to have your staff do in order to be able to use the internet-related services, that would be eligible. And any installation and configuration charges, your one-time installation fees for getting the internet connected or something set up. This is something new, too, that they've added, that you can have someone else actually provide the installation if needed. Previously, if you had a contract that you had originally, you purchased the equipment, you'd have to have it built into that contract that the installation was coming along with it. But now you no longer have to do that. The FCC realized, as I said, they're always updating their what's eligible, that people are getting these equipment from all over the place. You can get routers and servers on Amazon, on Tiger Direct, different websites online, and then have, you know, just purchase the equipment from there and then have someone locally do the installation. You can now have that installation cost also covered, get discount on that installation charge through E-rate. Yes, and someone did ask also, do we have a contract? We do have a contract with a provider for the basic maintenance, so we could get refunds or a discount for the software also. Yes, whatever software that's included in needing to run your internet access, you could get a discount on that as well. So those are the things that are eligible for E-rate in Category 1 and Category 2. Any other questions about the items that are eligible? All right. On to the Category 2 budgets. There we go. So how do you get the money for Category 2? As I said, it is done differently than Category 1. Category 1 is that calculation using your school lunch numbers and your urban or rural status, and then you just get a discount on that. And my camera view just went off. What's going on? All right, I've lost my camera view for a second, but we'll just continue anyways. Category 2 budgets are what USAC has done is they have created a what I can consider as a fake budget, pretend budget that you can work with to get yourself these services. I'm going to try something here with my camera to get it back up. Alright, I guess we're just going to skip the camera for the rest of the day. I'm sorry about that. Okay. Alright, one more try and then we'll just... Sorry about this. I just want to see if I can get this taken care of or if we have just lost it. All right, no camera. Sorry about that. Anyway, on to Category 2 budgets. Sorry. USAC has created what they have fake budgets, that, as I describe them, where a certain amount of money that you can use to cover all of these Category 2 services that you might have. It's a five-year budget starting in whatever year you want to start, anytime from 2015 through 2019 is you can have as your start year. So you could have started last year, but you can also just start with the upcoming 2016 year. This is for all your Category 2 services that do the internet, provide the service within your library, not for any of the Category 1, which is your monthly phone or your internet. That is done the traditional way. You are free to go over what they designate as your particular budget. That's fine. You don't have to say we can only spend this much money. You'll just only receive an E-rate discount on the amount that they say this is what we think would be a good budget for you to have over the next 5 years. How is the budget calculated? For libraries, this is calculated based on the actual size of your library building. How many total square feet there is in the library. So, and it is at $2.30 per square foot, but there is a minimum. If you have a really small building, so 4,000 square feet or less, you'll get a minimum of $9,200 as your budget no matter what, no matter how small you are. If you're in a larger area, a larger city or urbanized area, and your population is 250,000 or more, they've bumped it up to $5 per square foot, knowing that in those areas there would be higher cost to do install the internet potentially. So, for example, if your library is 3,500 square feet, multiply that times $2.30, and you get $8,050. However, you have that $9,200 minimum, so you actually have a pre-discount budget of $9,200. So they're saying before you start applying your discount, that's your budget. Now, you do use your discount calculation, as we did before, to figure out how much money you'll actually get in E-rate funds. So in this example, they've said that a library has a 50% discount rate, so based on their school lunch calculation there. And so they will actually receive $4,600 in E-rate funds to spend on Category 2 services over the next 5 years. So you figure out your full budget that they consider that you could use, and then you apply your discount rate, and then that's how much in funding you can potentially get for your Category 2 services. Now, you can use this money in any way that you want. You have 5 years to spend it. You could spend it all in the first year. If you're doing some big construction project, that might be a good idea. You might need to do that. Or you could spend it up and decide you're going to divvy it up between the next 5 years evenly, or use it as needed in each year. It's going to just depend on your situation, how you want to use it, and how you will apply it. Each year, when you apply for E-rate, you will say, okay, in the next year, I'm going to be buying some routers and servers and certain things. And E-rate, USAC will actually track your account, your amount that you've used, and deduct that and let you know how much you have left to use over the time. So they will keep track of a running total to let you know what's going on with your monies. It can be recalculated. It is actually officially recalculated every year. So hopefully it won't go down for you. Hopefully your libraries won't shrink. but potentially they could go up if you're building, if an addition added to your building, or you build a new library building or something. That could be something that would then make your calculation go up. The recalculation really applies more for schools. They use their calculation is based on the number of students enrolled in the school rather than the square feet like a library is. So for them, having it recalculated is going to make more sense every year. But for libraries, it'll probably stay pretty much the same, but they will officially recalculate it, just making sure that your square footage is still the same. So as you do your applications, you'll say we want to do something in Category 2, so we're starting our five-year countdown, and this is what we're going to use this year, and then what's left, and then next year we'll come back and let you know what we're going to use for the next year, and on. So each year you'll tell them new what is you're going to be looking for. Oh, here's a good question. Do we need to have the rest of the budget funds available in our local budgets? So for example, if we get 60% from USAC, do we need the 40% from local funds? Well, you need it from somewhere. It can be from wherever, but you're only going to get the certain amount of monies that is done by this calculation from USAC. So they are saying you have, as far as E-rate's concerned, let's say this, for E-rate purposes, you have a budget of $9,200, and they're going to give you $4,600 in funds that you can spend on any of your Category 2 services over 5 years. If that works for you, that's great. Then E-rate funds will cover all of that. But if you spend more than that, then yes, you would have to make up the difference. E-rate won't be able to do that. So it's going to depend on what your calculation is and what you're spending it on. And what this is, it's different from Category 1 in that Category 1 is here's your bill and now you're going to get a 50% discount on it. Category 2 is here's how much money you have to spend in Category 2 services. And we'll just every year give you the money when you tell us you need something, rather than here's your bill, here's what you paid, and now you have to, it's going to be discounted by this much, by the discount rate. Does that make sense? So rather than, it's not that like your service costs, for example, I don't know if this is even good, $1,000 to install some wiring,
you don't get 50% of that. You don't get only 500 of that. You get the $1,000 because that's what you've got to spend, and you can use it up as it goes throughout the 5 years. So it's a different point of view. You have to look at Category 2 budgets, Category 2 funding, than from Category 1 funding. Does anybody have any other questions? I know it is a little confusing. It's something brand new that we haven't done before. But they're hoping this will help more schools and libraries get more of this construction done, new wiring put in, higher, faster, upgraded internet services. All right, let me know if you have any other questions. Any questions about what we've gone through so far? What's eligible, what E-rate is, calculating your discount? All right. Up next, technology planning. You've had to do tech plans before, many of you have. They are no longer required. I can hear the cheers out there. Yes, cheer, cheer. Yes, no longer required for E-rate purposes. So you do not have to have a technology plan. You do not have to send it to me to have me approve it for you. But it is still a good idea to have one. It doesn't hurt to have something like that. Eligible, ready for you. It will definitely help you with your Category 2 applications. Technology plans can help you plan for the future, figure out what you're going to do over the next 5 years with your technology plan, and then you'll know each year what you can apply, what you'd want to apply for E-rate for Category 2 services. Also, if you are applying for accreditation here in Nebraska, it is one of the things you can earn points for in your accreditation. If you have a technology plan, you can earn some points for that. So it's a good idea for that as well. But it is no longer required. You will still see the question appear on the 46, the form 4, they ask, do you have a technology plan? You just have to say no. There's a choice to say no, none is required for me. It's still there because some libraries are still needing to use that form for previous years when it was still required. Requirement. But generally speaking, from now forward, you do not have to worry about having one. Now, the last thing that I have libraries look at and think about when they're considering doing E-rate is CIPA. This is our Children's Internet Protection Act, and this only relates to anything internet related. So your internet access and all your internal connections. So that's your monthly internet bill, which is B Category 1 service, and then your internal connections, which are all the Category 2 services. This does not apply or have anything to do with just your basic telephone. If you do want to receive E-rate funding for anything internet related, you do need to be in compliance with CIPA. I know many libraries are already, and that's great. You're all good to go then if you do do this. If you're not, this may be something to look into if you want to start receiving E-rate discounts. CIPA is very simple. It only requires three things, that you have an internet safety policy, which many libraries already have. You have something in writing that says what people can and can't do on your computers. They can't do anything illegal. They can't hack your systems, things like that. You have to have a technology protection measure. That's their official terminology for a filter. And this can be anything. Something that's individually installed on each workstation, something at your server level, something that your service provider does for you as far as filtering. The technology protection measure in CIPA, it is does not have to be very strict. I know CIPA can be a very controversial subject. There are all variations of what people think of it as far as the filtering part goes, all the way from librarians who say, no, do not ever put filters on the computers. We are all about freedom of information, and that is censorship, and that is wrong, so I will never, ever do it. All the way to the people who say, protect the children, you know, you need to have filters on everything and block, block, block all the bad things and everything in between. What's great about CIPA for our purposes, now I only speak to CIPA about, I only speak about CIPA in relation to using it for E-rate. What's great about CIPA is it is very vague. It's a very short act, 14, 15 pages, depending on how you print it out. And it doesn't give a lot of details. It does not say what filters you have to use. It does not say what websites you have to block. It just says you have to have a filter of some sort, That's their technology protection measure. And you have to block things that visual images that may be harmful to minors. Things like obviously maybe obscene or harmful to minors. As usual, it doesn't give a good definition of what that would be, so that's all up to debate for every community. You decide on your own what you think your level is and put in your filter. One thing it also says is, something else that it also says is that you have to have the ability to turn off the filter for anyone who's an adult, and it does say adult is 17 or above, any adult who wants to do bona fide research of some sort. They come and say, I'm trying to do this, write this paper on breast cancer research, you know, breast cancer, and it's blocking anything with the word breast in it. You have to have the ability to go there and turn it off for them. Really not a lot of censorship there when you can actually turn it off. So it's great for us for E-rate purposes. The only other thing you have to have is it says you're a public notice in a meeting or hearing. Basically, let your community know that you're going to be doing that, doing this, so that you can they can have a voice in it and say whether what they think or not. There's information on the USAC website there. I've got the URL for you about what all the rules and things related to it. But if you have not done it before, if you've not put filters on your computer and you're looking to get more discounts on things like your internet or your wiring and cabling and routers, building a new lab, building a new library, for example, possibly, look into it and see, you know, what is the what you do need to do. Covering this with a bare minimum will get you your E-rate funding, is what I say. You know, once you have this installed, you can then use it as you want to, and to what level of filtering you want to do. Oh, and we do have a question here about this. Does a library have to do the public notice and meeting each year they request E-rate funding? No, you only have to do that once. Either if you did it potentially when you first, if you've already got filtering, you may have had some sort of discussion in your community about is this good, is this bad, had it on a library board agenda of some sort, and that will work just fine. But you only have to do it once, and just keep a record of that you did have that meeting. If there was an agenda from a board meeting or agenda from a public meeting, stick it in your E-rate file so that you do have a record, remember when you did do that. So no, you only have to do that once. If you've already got your filters installed and you haven't had this public meeting, you want to do that to then become compliant with this so that you can get your E-rate funding, and that's fine as well. But just that's just a one-time thing. You do have to maintain your filters, of course, every year, but you only have to have that public notice and or meeting just one time. Any other questions about that? All right. On to our forms. Now, we've gone through all the basics of E-rate, what it is, what you can get a discount on, how much of a discount, other things you have to take into consideration before applying. Now, we're going to get into the actual forms and the process itself for the pretty much the next half of the workshop. Any other questions about what we've done for the first half so far, though? All right. Feel free to toss them up there at me in the question section whenever you do think of them, though. So there are four basic forms that you submit for E-rate. And as I said earlier, E-rate is done throughout the year. So these are each submitted at a certain time of year, not all at once, not a whole bunch of forms you have to do and sit down and do all of these. You do them at a certain time throughout the year. So it is spread out, hopefully not nearly as intimidating as it sounds. The first three forms on this list, every applicant has to submit. The fourth form will depend on how you get your discount, and this new form will also depend on how you get your discount. I'm going to explain all of these. The first form, 470, where you're just saying, I'm looking for a service. I want to get E-rate on a particular service. The 471, you tell E-rate who you've picked to be your provider and what service they ended up giving you. The 486, you then tell them the service has actually started. We've actually started receiving the service. That's when you can start getting your funding after that. The fourth form, where says the 472 or 474, that will depend on how you get your money. You can either have a discount on your bills directly from your provider, or you can get a reimbursement check, a reimbursement after you have paid your bills in full. And that will depend on those different form for different process. And I've got, we're going to go into a lot more detail on all of these. This is just a quickie introduction here. Something new with getting your reimbursements is this Form 498. This is where you will now get direct deposit into your library's bank account of this funding. It used to be a check that was cut to you, but now it will be a direct deposit, and you'll fill out a new form if you want to do that, that will give USAC your bank information for that. Now, this is the general timeline for E-rate. This is what a lot of people ask is, when do I need to do a form? What is the deadline for a form? So this, I've got a general timeline here, and when we have some more specific dates, I'll have it more detailed on our website. A funding year you're currently applying for, this is for funding year 2016 that was upcoming, is, as I said earlier, July 1st, 2016 through June 30th, 2017. So as I said, you're looking to the future. Right now, you can submit the first form, which is your Form 470. This is where you ask for the services. Say we're looking to get E-rate on certain services. As it says here, you usually start filing this around October, November, December, whatever that we're into now. People always ask, what is the deadline for the 470? Well, the deadline for the 470 is actually based on the deadline for the second form in the E-rate process, your 471. The 471 form is what is used, you use to tell USAC who you've picked as a provider or who you want to be your provider, what it's going to cost, what your discount is, all what you've come up with and decided to go with. This is only available, this form, during a certain 3-month-ish so period of time called the application filing window. This filing window varies every year, so the dates are different each year. It's not the same dates every year. It varies every year, and they announce every year what those dates are going to be. So far, they have not announced those dates for this year, so I do not have for you what our deadline will be for the 471 or for the 470 yet. As soon as those are announced, I'll have them on our website. USAC will release them on theirs. I'll put it out on our mailing lists and our blog and everything. But as of today, I just checked, they have not announced what that actual filing window is. The way the filing window usually runs, as I said here, December through March. I'm hoping it's sometime soon, let us know. It's usually about the time when you can do that second form. The first form, your 470, has to be posted for 28 days before you can do your 471. When you put out your 470, you're putting out an open call to providers to potentially provide you with your construction, your wiring, your equipment, and you have to give them enough time, and the FCC has said the legal amount of time they want you to give is 28 days. Then you can do your 471. So once we have our window dates for the 471, whatever the end date is of that, we back up 28 days, and that's the end, that's the deadline for the 470. So once our window's announced, we'll have a date sometime maybe in March. Once we know that, we subtract 28 days. Usually it ends up sometime in February is the deadline for the 470. Keep your eyes and ears open for when that date's announced. I've been looking every day. So right now, as I said, it is the start of the process of the 470, but we have plenty of time. They haven't even announced the window. You're going to have plenty of time to do the 470 if you have not done it yet. So we're not coming up to any deadlines yet that you need to be worrying about. Once you've done those first two forms, however, that's when you that your application is finally reviewed. You first say what service you're looking for, then you say who you'd like to be your provider and who you want, what the cost will be, and then USAC evaluates all the applications, reviews all the applications. It goes to their Program Integrity Assurance Department, PIA review, and they will look over your application. That can take months and months to do. So once you do get your first two forms submitted, that's when you sit back and wait, and potentially wait and wait. They may contact you with questions, definitely answer them. That will help them approve your application and get all the information they need to do it. After that is done and they've gone through everything, then they'll start issuing their funding commitment decision letters. This is the letters that tell you whether you have been funded or not. They can start in the spring. As soon as that window closes, they can start sending those letters out if they've got some really easy, quick applications to apply. But they can go on for months. For the most recent year, for 2015, they finished sending almost all those out by the end of September. So it did go into the funding year, you'll notice. The funding year starts in July, so that's when your discounts could start. They were still sending out these letters in September. That's okay. No matter whenever you get your letter, you will get your discount going back to July. So if you had your monthly bills, you were still paying in full because you hadn't received the letter yet, the funding commitment letter, your service provider will know you've gotten that now, and they will give you discounts retroactive to the beginning of July. So even if you haven't gotten your letter yet, don't fear, you will get your full amount of money. But do be prepared to pay your bills in full just in case there is a delay in getting those letters out, or if they're still working on all the applications they have. They get last year, I believe they got somewhere between 45 to 50,000 applications. So it took a long time to get through all of them, definitely. So just be prepared that you might have to pay your full bill for a while. Once you get that letter, you do still have to tell E-Rate, yes, we want the money. That's the 486 form. So you get your funding commitment letter, and you immediately sit down and do your 486. There's no delay. You don't have to wait. As soon as you see that letter, you can sit down and do that. This is where a lot of people lose the process. They get this letter, and they think it says you've been approved. And they say, yay, I did it. I got my money. Well, no. What that actually means is the money's been set aside for you, and now you have to let us know that you actually want it. Your situation may have changed. You may have found a cheaper provider. Your pricing could have changed. Something, who knows what could have happened. They still need you to let them know, yes, please do give me the money, and that is the 486. Like I said, a lot of people kind of get that funding commitment decision letter and say and think they're done, but they're not. There's that one more form you definitely have to do. And as I said, there's no reason, you don't have to wait at all, sit down, do it. At the same time as you're doing that, you'll also want to figure out how you're going to get your reimbursement, and this you do working with your service provider. You can get a discount on your bills if you want to, and the service provider will do that for you, or you can get the reimbursement afterwards and get a deposit put into a bank account for the library. So you do those at the same time as you're doing the 46, so that's all taken care of and figured out together. And I'll go into a lot more detail about all these forms as well. This is not the only slide we have if you've looked at the presentation I sent you about all of this. But this is just your basic timeline so that you can keep track of what to do and at what time of year. Now, anything related to your E-rate application, libraries must keep copies of any paperwork, anything related to it, for 10 years after the last date of service. Now, this is new. It used to be 5 years. They have upped it to 10. You do not have to suddenly find things from 10 years ago. No, it's just starting with the current of the 2015, you'll have to keep things longer. For the upcoming 2016 funding year, you'll have to keep anything related to it through 2027 is what that means. So any contracts you've signed, any paperwork, any documentation about your filters, any bills, all of that, you just need to stick in a file and hold on to it for 10 years. You do not have to keep them actually in paper format, however. You can do them electronically if you want to scan things scan all your documents that you have and just put them on a flash drive somewhere or put them in a file folder somewhere. That's perfectly fine. They do not have to be actually in paper files and drawers and drawers of file cabinets. You just need to be able to have access to them in case USAC comes back asking. This 10-year timeline means that they can go back that far if they want to, if they want to do an audit. Now, an audit in E-rate terms does not mean the same thing as it means in IRS terms. It is most of the times they do audits, it's for just a checks and balances type thing. They're making sure the program works correctly. Did you get all your forms submitted on time? Did you understand the process? Was there any issues? But also checking, do you have all the documentation you said you were going to have? They do have to make sure that the program is still, up and up, keeping up with what it's supposed to be doing. With the new E-rate portal that we're going to be seeing in just a second, that I'm sure you've all heard of, this new interface for doing E-rate, all of this information that's on the E-rate side will be kept in there for you. So any of your forms and anything that you've sent to E-rate, they will hold on to in their own servers for you. Anything you don't ever send to them, you'll have to keep track of your keep hold of yourself. So between those two places, whatever E-rate has for you and anything extra that you have, you'll have to keep for 10 years. For the SIPA documentation, you'll keep that forever because from the first time you've done that, it will always be have something to do with all of your future E-rate applications. So those you'll never get rid of. You just keep a copy of it always somewhere so that you can have access to it. Now, the things you need to keep in some way or way, shape, or form, either in your hands or in E-rate's hands, all your forms you've applied, you've submitted, all their letters they've sent back to you, acknowledging receipt of them. Every time you send a form to E-rate, they send you back a letter saying, we got it. Anything else they've contacted you with, if they've asked questions of you, if they've sent you, we need more information, or here's an update, keep all of those. If you did receive bids from companies or contracts and agreements, all of those things that you've received. Any of your receipts for actual physical equipment, all of that. So just anything that was anything you got an E-rate discount on or anything that was related to you getting a discount, anything you used to refer to, you have to keep for that 10-year period. So any questions about this so far? All right. On to what I'm sure you've all been dying to see here and want to see is our new E-rate portal, the E-rate Productivity Center. Is our new E-rate portal. The acronym is EPC, but it is pronounced EPIC. So this is EPIC, our new E-rate Productivity Center. How EPIC it will be is to be determined. We'll see as we have to start using it. Everything will now be done through this interface, starting with funding year 2016. Filing all your forms, submitting all of your contracts to them if you need to show them any bills, answer any questions back and forth, all is done through this system now. No more paper forms. There's not going to be any PDFs available of the forms anymore. There's not going to be anything that you will email or fax or mail in to USAC anymore for E-rate. It will all be done back and forth through this portal. It's more than just a place to just submit forms. It's got a, and we'll see the screenshots of it in a second, it's called a mailbox, an email system where you can send questions. They can send you questions back and forth. This is a link to get to it directly, but you can also get it really quickly from some buttons right on the E-rate website that I'll show you. So why are they doing this? This was part of the modernization. FCC directed USAC to make it simpler, simplify the process, make it easier for everyone to apply, and get everything online. Get rid of the paper. Streamline it all. So all of your forms, all your status of your applications, all of the times when the PIA reviewers contact you with questions, all of that is going to be just in one place. Searching for all your forms. Previously, a lot of these things were in different places, and they still are on the E-rate website. But now for your particular E-rate account, it's all in one place. So all of your forms, all of your requests, all your documentation there. Another thing that's an advantage, which I think is potentially the coolest part of it, is you can now use this from any device. You can use it from your desktop computer, laptop, all the way down to your smartphone if you want to. You'll be able to access this. USAC has contracted with an outside country called Appian, I think it's how it's pronounced, and they have this as a service that it's already a pre-built system, and they've just put their E-rate stuff into that. So it works everywhere. Now, I would not recommend completing an E-rate form on your smartphone. Definitely don't do that. But as far as checking an application status or replying to a request from them potentially, definitely you could log in on your smartphone for that, no problem. So any sort of device you want, and even more importantly, any browser. Cheers again, yes. Previously, certain E-rate forms, you had to be using Internet Explorer to use them successfully. It was just a requirement of the form is they said they did not, we've asked previously about this, they did not have the programmer's availability to reprogram all of their online forms to work in all different browsers, so they only did them in the IE. Last year, they finally got some, a couple of forms, the 470 and the 471, working in other browsers, but still only the first two forms. Other ones you still had to, if you want to do it online, had to be in Internet Explorer. If you didn't do it in Internet Explorer, you would think you submitted a form and it didn't actually go through. I had this happen many times with many libraries. You hit submit and it didn't actually give an error message saying, hey, you're using the wrong browser. It just let you think you did. Now with this new interface, you can use anything. You can use, if you want to use IE, you're free to use it. Or you can use Firefox, Chrome, Safari, whatever your browser of choice is, you can use that. So any browser, any device, you can access this portal. That's a huge improvement. Also, you can update. You will have an account here in here for your library where you can store all of your information about your library, your address, your contact info, your school lunch numbers. All of that is saved in your library's profile and then is automatically put into the forms when you need to submit each one, so you don't have to re-enter them every time. This is a great improvement. You don't have to keep doing things over and over again. It's all saved in there. As far as our consortias and our service providers, they will also have an easy list and access to you as their clients. So that is a huge, it makes it much easier for them on their side as well. Something else you will no longer need is your personal identification number, your PIN. This was that mishmash of numbers and letters and characters that nobody could ever remember that you needed to use as your electronic signature to sign off and certify on all of your forms. You can get rid of those. You don't need that anymore. When you log into the portal, you're going to have a username, which is your own email address, and a password of your choosing that you create to log in. Once you're logged into the portal, you have access to everything, all of your forms, all of your library's information. So you don't need that PIN number anymore. The security codes you used to have to remember as you went through a certain point in your 470 and 471, it said write down the security code to get back into this form or else you won't be able to. That no longer exists at all anymore either. Logging into your portal gets you access to everything you were doing. So much easier not to have that PIN number or security codes to remember. You will have one account administrator that will create, and you can have many people have access to your account as well. So you do not have to have just the one person who can do your E-rate. If you have multiple people that might want to do it, if you have a backup person, if you're lucky enough to have that, they can all have be set up as users in the portal by your administrator. There are different levels of it, of rights that you can have for people. A full user can do everything. You can submit the forms, file them, certify them, update your organization information. Partial users can complete forms but not submit and certify them. This is, for example, if you've got one person, maybe your tech person helped to submit, create the form, but only the director has the authority to sign off on it. You would have the one person submit it and then pass it off to the director to do the submission. There's also a view-only category where people can just look at the in everything in there but can't actually do anything to your forms or your application information, but they can update the organizational info for your library. Oops, went too far. Now, USAC has created, what they attempted to do was create an account for one person in your organization as the account administrator. What they started off with was anyone, whoever was the person listed on your funding year 2015 471. So last year's application, the second form in the process, whoever submitted that form, they automatically create an account for. That person is designated as your account administrator and then has access to all of everything that's in there on your library and has the ability to add other users to the account. Back in July of this year, they sent out emails to everyone who they determined was this category of person. It didn't work for everyone. Some people didn't get the email. They actually sent it out with no preliminary information, no heads up letting you know it was coming. So many people were confused, didn't pay attention to it, deleted it. It was an email that said, your account's been set up in this Epic thing. Come and, log in. with no information about what that was, not understandably, and I would too, people didn't want to just jump into some system they'd never heard of before. So some of those emails got lost in the process. That's okay. Your account is still set up in there anyways. You just need, and I'll show you how to get into it and actually get access to it, even if you didn't have those emails or lost them or whatever. If you don't have access to it and something's going a little wonky and you can't get access, you can contact their client service bureau, which is OO, which is USAC's customer service people, and they'll get you set up with your account. But once you're in there, you can have your, as you see here, your own independent school or library, or if you're a district or library system, all of all those different organization types are in there once you get into the your Epic account. Now, to get to this, you go to start off with the USAC website. I also have a link to it from our Nebraska Library Commission E-Rate website. There is a, they've created a blue box right there at the bottom that says E-Rate Productivity Center, and the very first item under your resources and tools also gets you into it. Once you click on either one of those, you get to this screen, where right at the top it has your login button, and that's where you'll go to get in, and I'll show you that in just a second. But I want to show you first is just below that is these additional resources. You can see there's a glossary of terms, some frequently asked questions, but there's also a whole lot of user guides and tutorials. This is a huge new system, and they know it may be a bit confusing to some people, and so they have created a, and are still creating a lot of help for you. So right now you can see there's user guides for getting into the system and using it, and then working on your first form in the process, the 470. Right now the 470 is the only form available in the system because that's the only one you can submit at the moment. They just have user guides and information for that, but as the other forms get added, they will add instructions for that as well. The tutorials are really good. Each one is, the longest one is maybe 10 minutes. They're really short, quick bites of information, just how to do each of these things. So I strongly recommend you take a look at these videos and the user guides. They will really, definitely really help you get through using this new interface. And the user guide is great, too. I like what they've done with that. Rather than being one giant, huge document, they've broken it out into each section of it is its own PDF, so you can just look at what you want to, what you need to know about. Epic is a work in progress. They're going to be making changes to it, adding things to it. As obviously the new forms will be in there as they become, as you need to submit them. So they're going to be doing these special editions of their news briefs. USAC does a weekly news brief where they send an email blast out to anybody who signs up about new things going on in E-Rate or who's been received discounts and some tips and tricks on how to submit your application, information about deadlines. But they're adding one. Whenever they do make some major changes, they're going to do this release notes news brief specifically about the Epic system. So if you want to keep up on when they've changed things, sign up for this on their website and you'll keep up to date on that. So now we're going to get into actually seeing how this new interface works. As I said, these emails were sent out in July, most of them, and they had this subject line of USAC Epic account creation. And it says your USAC E-Rate Productivity Center account's been created, and it's all with your username is just your email address, easy to remember. And it tells you to log in, and it gives you the URL to go to, and it says here, and I've highlighted this, select the forgot password option to actually get set up in the system. This is something that is not very intuitive, not how you've ever probably set up yourself at any other online systems before. Most systems you have a create an account choice or a sign up choice. For whatever reason, the way this company starts you off with is they set you up with an account inside the system and you have to pretend that you forgot your password and reset it to then get yourself access to it. Kind of a roundabout way to do it, but it's how it works. So once you do click on that link or go to the login link here on the E-Rate Productivity Center page. Either way, you can get to it. If you don't have the email, you just go to that link there. You get this brief little, I agree to the using of the system. And then it brings you to the login screen. Since you don't have a password yet, you just type in your username, which is your email address, and click the forgot password link. It brings you to where you can enter your username again and request a password reset. You maybe have done this before. I know I've done it many times on websites that I've forgotten what my password is. You just request that password reset, and they will then send you an email that gives you a link to reset your password. It's only valid 15 minutes, but usually you're doing it right then and there, so that's not a problem. If you get to this point and you don't get an email and it doesn't send you something, that means they didn't actually have an account they set up for you yet, for whatever reason. There was some difficulty with some people's email addresses or getting them set up from the USAC side. So for some people, if you don't get this, you need to then just contact them, and I've got their 800 number here at the end of the slides, and say, I am the E-rate person for this particular library, and I need to have my Epic account set up, and they'll get you set up for it. But if you do have an account in there, you'll get this email to let you reset your password. It'll then go here where you type in your username again, your email address, and create your own password. Pick whatever you want, following these rules. So, typical password creation rules. 8 characters long, a letter, a number, a special character, one uppercase, one lowercase. So following all those rules, create something, anything you want to remember for yourself. Now, something they have also said that we have, I'll say argued with them about, but this may be a limitation of the system itself. These passwords, according to the company, need to be reset every 60 days. Yes, 60 days is a very short amount of time. It is not really necessary once you've got a password that is this strong, but that's a limitation of the system at the moment. We've tried to tell them that's not going to really work for us, as in many libraries will only be submitting forms every 60 days, so every time you do this, you'll have to create a new password. It is going to be a hardship, an annoyance, yes. What I recommend is, as you can see here, they say, your password cannot have been used in the previous 4 passwords. What I'm going to do, for me, create 5 different passwords that are just a little off from each other and just keep rotating through them every time I need to do this. Keep them, keep them as a reminder with them somewhere so that you know what they are. That's a way to work through this, unless we can convince them to change that limitation of the system. For now, that is how it will work. So once you've got your password reset, you will reset password. It will then set you to this link saying your password has been reset and you may now log in using your new password. Click on that little link and it bumps you back to the sign-in screen where you can now use that password to actually sign into the system. And the last thing you have to do to set up your account is agree to their terms and conditions. And it automatically defaults you to that, where you can click on the link to complete the terms and conditions, and it will bring up, this is that long thing that we all read, beginning to end, right? And at the very bottom of it, you accept their terms, and then you are good to go for using the system. This is something you only have to do once the first time you set up your account. And once that is done, you are dumped here to your landing page. This is your homepage. This is where you will start and keep track of everything to do with your account. When anywhere you are in this system, the USAC logo, this USAC with the yellow swoosh across the top of it, that logo will be on almost on every page within the system. Anytime you click on that, it'll pop you back to this landing page. There's information about your library, forms you submitted, and everything on here. Across the top, there is 5 different sections of the Epic system: news, tasks, records, reports, and actions. The first section, news, is where you'll get all your updates to things. Any new forms that have been submitted, any communication with other users in your organization, notification letters saying that they've received a form will all go in here. You will no longer receive letters in the mail. Everything, all of your communication with USAC will be done through here. So you'll no longer receive those colored letters, pink, yellow, and blue letters that we used to have color coordinated each year. It will all just be here within the USAC system. The second section is your tasks. This is all your forms in process. If you started a form and haven't finished it, something needs to be done, undone things, this will be here under your tasks. Records, this is where all your forms are kept here. You can see here, for now we have a list of FCC Form 470s. You can manage and update your info here, your applicant information, your service providers, your users, all that can be here. The next section is route reports. They don't have anything in here yet, actually. They're looking for input on what kind of reports we would want out of the system. So for now, it just gives you a link to pop back to your main homepage, your landing page. So hopefully we'll be giving them some more advice on what we might want to get reports out of here. And then actions, these are things you can do within the system. You can search for your 470s, contact their customer service, all those kind of things. So back to your landing page. The upper right-hand corner of the landing page is your username information. This is a demo account that I use for some of these screenshots. So it says Library System 11. That will be your name up there usually, you as the user. And a couple of different, when you click on, there's a little caret link next to that. You open up a pull-down menu there, and it has where you can do make updates to your profile and settings. And this is where you can sign out of the system if you want to. It does have an automatic inactivity timer of 60 minutes. So if you step away from the screen, from your desk, or go off the screen after an hour, 60 minutes will automatically log you out. But if you click on the profile, you get this screen where they've made it, it's kind of like a social networking type site. Obviously, this type of system can be used for other things, but you can put in a profile picture and a screen, change that background if you want to. If you feel the need, sure. Nobody else is going to see it but you at this point. But in the upper right-hand corner there, it has where you can manage your Epic user profile, and this is where you can update your personal info. So change the name, your name, address, phone number, all that basic information about you as a user. If you clicked on the settings option here, then you would get where you can change your language you use the system in. I think default into English is fine. Calendar type and time zone. Definitely double check the time zone. Make sure it falls in whatever time zone you're in, Central, Mountain, whatever, because all of our forms are due on a certain date at a certain time. It's always 11:59 p.m. on whatever day. Make sure it knows what time zone you're in so it knows when your actual deadline is. Mine did default to Central, so it knew where I was, but just double check it to play it safe. So that's you as a user. This, you can also, since you are the administrator of the account, the first person given access, you can manage users up there in the top menu. And this is where you can add new users if you have other people that you want to have access to working on your E-rate forms. You can add and remove them and manage their permissions. So here's just a blank form. You just enter new information for a new person. This would also be what you would do if you were maybe the current E-rate person and you're leaving the library. If you're the director, you're moving on, you'd set up the new person as this, or if you're passing on the information, you're having someone else do E-rate now for you, this is where you can create an account for that person. Down at the very bottom, and I've zoomed it in here, is where you can tell what kind of permission the person can have, and they remind you here of what the difference is between the full, partial, and view only. Back to the landing page again, you can also from here manage your organization information. This is information about the library. Now, in this example they have as the demo, it's got a library system with multiple branches. You, as an individual library, would just have one option here. And it just has all the information about your library that you can change, address, phone number, all the basics. So any questions about the interface itself? Let's get into the actual forms. We're going to go through each form, 470 mostly because that's the one that you can actually submit now, and then just some information about the other ones. As I said, the 470 is the only form that is available in the Epic system right now because it's the only one you can submit. So we don't have screenshots of anything else but it at the moment. Everything else is still a work in process. So 470. The purpose of the 470 is actually to officially open a competitive bidding process. This is, you are actually openly saying to any potential providers out there, we are looking for someone to provide us with a service, and this is what we want for that service to be, telephone, internet, what speed we want internet to be, all that. So you explain in there what this is. Now, for many libraries here in Nebraska, I know that looking for a provider is kind of not what you do because there aren't any options for providers in your area, and that is fine. You still have to go through the process, so to speak, you know, play the game here with E-Rate to make sure that you do get involved, you get the process going and get yourself into the system. So you post, the Form 470 says what you're looking for as a service. You have to do it, as I said earlier, at least 20 days before you actually pick who you're going to go with. Even if it's your current provider, that's fine. Sign your contracts if necessary. If you've got an ongoing contract, of course, you wouldn't be signing a new one. And then do your 471 telling USAC who you picked. Ideally, I'd have a filing window listed here letting everyone know when the filing window is for the 471, but we don't know that yet, so that is to be announced. There is one case where you don't have to actually do a 470, where you don't have to actually look for other providers. This is a new thing that just came with the new modernization. And as I said, FCC wanting libraries and schools to really get good internet at a good price, cost-effective price. If you can find some provider doing this service at this internet speed, at this cost, you can skip the 470 and you just wait for the 471 and let E-Rate know, we found someone who does this, that's who we're going with. And there is no competition, there's nothing to worry about. The bandwidth, your speed has to be at least 100 megabits to download, megabits per second, and 10 megabits per second upload at a cost of $300 per month or less. And also something that is publicly, commercially available to anyone. Now, at the moment, there's not a lot of companies that do offer this yet. I know I've heard this year there's been a few in some of the bigger areas that maybe are starting to provide these speeds. So you might have trouble finding it, definitely, most likely. But there are some that are on the edge. The idea is, I think, from the FCC's point of view, is if we make this something that a library can really quickly jump onto, that providers will notice it and they will start providing the service, and it will be kind of a self-fulfilling prophecy. We're going to give you easy E-Rate for it. Provide the service, get the libraries on board, libraries and users get good speed at a good price, and everyone benefits in the end. It's a win-win for the providers as well. They just need to be able to provide this speed. Sometimes that is a construction issue. They do not have the cabling or wiring to provide it, who knows. But look around for it. If you have a provider you're working with and they're kind of close to this, ask them. Say, hey, if you can bump up to this at this cost, we can skip all this competition and we can just go with E-Rate and we'd be happy to be with you. So look into this and see if, you know, maybe it's in your area. I predict it'll become more common in the few years as the providers notice that this is something out there and that the libraries and schools are asking for it. So it's going to become more common as time goes on. Now, to actually submit your 470, you go into your Epic account and click on the Apply Now button. Right now, that's the only thing it does your 470. As the other forms are added, they will have links to submit those as well. And it dumps you right into your 470, the start of it. It automatically enters your library info based on the organization information that you'd already provided. And it just asks for an application nickname. In this case, I have said 470 FY2016. So you do have to give it some sort of nickname. As with most databases, anywhere where there's a red asterisk is a required field. So they do require that. At the bottom, you've got three different buttons here that you can do. You can discard the form, save and share, and save and continue. Discard the form is really great. This is where if you have started a form by accident or don't want to continue anymore for whatever reason, you can delete the form out of yourself. And you can do that at any step in the process before you've submitted it, up until you submitted it. This is good if you've, in the past when you've done this, a lot of times libraries have started a form, got confused, thought they did something wrong, dumped out of it, and then gone in and done a second form, and the other one just kind of floated around out there doing nothing. And you'd have, if you wanted to get rid of it, you'd contact USAC, their customer service, and have them delete it for you. In this system, if you don't delete a partially started form, it will keep sending you email reminders to that you need to complete it. I discovered that the hard way by suddenly getting all these emails for like every couple of days saying, you've got this form to complete, you've got this form to complete. So definitely if you start one and you don't want to continue it, use that discard form button to get rid of it and just have your actual usable forms in the system. You can also save and share, which is saving it at this point and sharing it with someone else who's a user that you've set up in the Epic system, or save and continue, which just goes on to the next page in your 470. On this screen, there's nothing for you to do. You can see there's nothing to click on or change. Nothing is editable, but it does say we've completed the section based on information from your profile, your entity's profile, that's your library. And if anything needs to be changed, you've got to back out of this, go into the Manage Organization section that I showed you earlier and fix that information, then go back in here and continue your form. We're going to say everything is good, save and continue. If you had worked with a consultant, these are people you can pay to help you submit your forms. Usually large school districts and public library systems need someone, you know, an expert to help them. If not, that wouldn't be in your profile information that's blank. But then are you the contact person? If you are, you say yes. If you're not, you say no. If you say yes, it just automatically dumps in your user info. Save and continue, and then this is where we can choose our category of service, choose what we're going to ask for a rate discount on. And they've got category 1 and category 2 listed there, and they tell you what they all are for. And you can do either category 1, you click on it, it turns it green, just category 2, click on it, or you can do both all together on 1-470. You don't have to do separate forms for each one. So you can do it all at one shot. Now, if you're not sure what you want to do, you can do a Category 1 form now and then later on do another 470 for Category 2. That's fine. But you can do them all together at once if you want to. So we save and continue that. And that's going to ask, do we have an RFP or request for a proposal? This is not required for E-rate purposes. Depending on what you're getting, you can usually give a good description within your form itself of what you're looking for. But if you have a really large project, a building project, you probably have something more complex that you need to explain when you're looking for providers or contractors. If you said yes, it would give you a chance to upload that contract into your Epic system and attach it to this application. You don't have to mail it, fax it, scan it. It's just find it wherever it is and upload it right into there. If you don't, and we're going to say we don't for this purpose, you say no, and you save and continue. And now here's where you can start adding your particular service requests. Each service that you're going to ask for is a different new service request. Your phone, your internet, if you're purchasing equipment, doing installation, each of those things is a separate request. You got to add each of them one at a time into your 470 to let people know what you're looking for. So in this case, I'm going to do a Category 1. I'm going to click on the Add New Service Request, the green button there, and it's going to give me a pull-down menu on the next screen of all the things that are available under the Category 1. This is where my fiber, my cell service, the very bottom of this list is your voice service. That is all of your telephone services there. Lit fiber, dark fiber, and the internet options for your basic monthly internet bill. This is where people get a little confused too. There is transport only, no ISP service included. Then farther down, there's internet access and transport bundled, and then there's internet access ISP service only. Now the difference between these is, the important part here is that transport is when you have data connections that need to be connected between different buildings, a wide area network. So you've brought in the internet service somehow to one building, and now you've got multiple locations that need to have it dispersed out to. Most of our libraries here in Nebraska are individual buildings, so that doesn't apply. You can have that bundled with your internet access, the monthly bill, just bringing the connection into your library, that's your internet access and transport bundled. But if you're just an independent library, an individual single building, and you're just getting your ISP brought to the building, that's internet access ISP service only. And that's the one that you would pick most likely. Unless, like I said, unless you have other buildings that you need to send the internet out to when it's come to one, you don't choose anything that mentions transport. So here I have chosen internet access ISP service only, and then it will ask you what your speed is you want, your minimum and maximum capacity. And it has just a pull-down menu of all those particular options. You definitely want to make your maximum over more than what you might even be getting now. You want to make it open to potentially getting a higher speed if you want to. If you get lower, that's fine. You just want it to be, when you're doing your 470, you need to be broad enough that whatever you get will be included somewhere in those numbers. So if you're currently only getting 5 megabits, don't just put 5 megabits per second. Maybe put 10, maybe put 20 if you're thinking ambitiously. If you maybe think someone in town might have this, or my provider might decide to offer it if I put it on here. So think bigger. This is your kind of dreaming about what you'd like to get on here. Make sure you can afford it if it does come down to it. You don't have to choose that highest one either. You can end up with whatever, you know, you agree to. Number of entities served, that's one. You're just a single library. And then it also does ask if you're doing any installation or activation, meaning is this a new install? And you would say yes or no to that and the maintenance questions. Now, those services will obviously be on your Category 2 application because that's where installation and maintenance comes in. But they do ask you, are you by any chance going to look for that for these, for this particular service? Then you would click the Add button once you've got that all done. And now you'll see it's now listed as one of your service requests under Category 1. You can then, in the narrative, describe what it's for, and I just wrote in here a very brief monthly internet access for our public library. If necessary, you can put that in there. If not, you don't have to. But now we'll add another service under Category 1, and we're going to do our telephone. So we have to go through it a second time, choose voice service, and in this case, ask some different questions. I'd only ask for quantity. What this means by quantity is number of phone lines coming in the building. So if you have a phone line and a fax line, that would be two. If you have two phone numbers coming in and a 800 number, that would be three. So however many phone lines you have coming in is what they want for quantity. And the same thing on the right, you're one entity, and do you need any installation or maintenance? Add that one, and now we have both of those at the top here showing what they are. Something else it asks for as well is this installment payment plan. This is something new that USEC is offering. If you have any other charges that are not E-rate eligible, you can pay them as a monthly plan and to make it easier for you to potentially get this new service and this new installation. If you arrange something like that with a provider, they want to know about that, and so you can let them know if that's potentially happening. Next, we'll add our Category 2 service. So down under its area, we click Add New Service Request down there. And now this will give us different choices because we have different things that we can do for Category 2 as Category 1. Here, you can see there's internal connections, basic maintenance of those internal connections, and managed broadband services. So you choose whichever one you want. Just for this example, I've just done internal connections. And you can see there it shows you all the kinds of equipment that you can get a discount on. And I did cabling, and I don't even know if this is an accurate guess, but I did 100 feet of cables. I don't know. I might need more. Depends on how big your library is. But you'll see for any of these kind of quantity things, it does tell you the unit it's asking for. So it gives you a tip on what it needs. You can choose a particular manufacturer if you want to for these equipments. I did no preference. Same thing. I'm a single entity, and, yeah, we want to have our cables installed. Thank you. We add that one, and you can see now that's listed under my Category 2 service requests. And if you had other ones, you just keep adding individual services until you've got everything on here that you're looking for the upcoming year. For this example, we're just going to say we're done. And at the bottom now, we have a save and continue button. We've got our same discard form, save and share, and save and continue buttons. When we continue after entering all that, it asks, do we have a tech contact person? Is there someone else who would be best to ask questions that are more of a more techie nature? If you're the person and you can answer all the questions of potential providers, say no. If there is, you'd say yes. And in this case, this is someone where you can add someone who you've added as a user to the system, or you can enter them manually. This person does not have to necessarily have an account with an Epic. Your IT person might not need to get in here to all your E-rate stuff, and that's fine. You can, as I've done in this example, just enter their contact info manually. It doesn't create an account for them in here. It has nothing to do with being in the Epic system. It's just a way to give a provider, access to someone to answer their questions.
Are there any state or local procurement requirements? This is a thing they're asking now in the form. Basically, are there any rules that restrict how you can procure your information, your do your bidding? In Nebraska, there is not anything state. If there's something local, you'd have to check on that with your municipality. In this case, I'm just going to say no. Oops. And now you'll see the last option here has changed to say review my form, not save and continue, because we're now done entering all the info we needed. When you hit review, it then generates a PDF for you. It takes a little bit of time to do this. It says here, please hit refresh to check if the document generation is complete. This is a static screenshot, but right here it's got one of those swirly things that keeps swirling as it's working on it. There's a green refresh button here. Just click it a couple of times. Keep going until it actually, if it's not done, it'll go back to this. But once it is done, it will bring you where you've got this link that you can click on to actually download and look at your PDF of your 470. You'll also see here there's a box to check to certify. And over here, just grayed out, is a continued certification button. You can't click on it yet because you haven't checked this box. So first, you click on this blue link, which is a hot link, and it brings up the PDF of your application. So all your information is there about your library. Beneath that, your different requests that you made. And then in this case, I've got my tech contact on the second page. So double check that. You can download that or print it out if you want to, the PDF version of your 470. But once you've decided it's all good, you check the box, and now we can continue to certification because the button's active for us. It says, are you sure you want to do this? This function will send you directly the certification. You say, I'll say yes. And then you get, this is where you get all those little boxes that you check off. This is all the legal stuff, and I'm going to zoom that out for you here. Certifying that you're the person to do this, that you are going to follow all the rules, that it is for educational library purposes, et cetera, et cetera. You have to check every single box. If you miss a box, it's going to pop out an error for you and tell you that you need to check them all. Once you check all the boxes, you click on the certify, the green certify button at the very bottom of the screen, and that's where it comes up with the scary legal pop-up. The scary legal pop-up that says, false statements on this form result in civil liability in our criminal prosecution. So just making sure, are you really, really wanting to do this? Say yes. And very briefly, it'll show you in the task that you need to certify. It's kind of got a little delay where it shows them there still. But as soon after that's done, it'll pop you back to your landing page, where you can see now we've got some information here under tasks and under your form. So at the bottom, you've got, in this case, I started one and I completed one and didn't complete one. I've zoomed that out for you here. The certified one here is the one I just finished, and this incomplete is one that I started and still needed to work on. At this point, this the nickname here is clickable, so you can actually get your HTML version of your form. Same thing as was in the PDF, just a different format. And you can take a look at it. Also, into your news section will automatically go your receipt acknowledgement letter. Every letter, every form you submit to USAC, they send you a letter. Previously, they were mailed to you in the mail. They were all on different colored pieces of paper, depending on what funding year it was. No more letters will be mailed to you. Nothing will come in the mail anymore. You won't be able to lose. You don't have to worry about losing envelopes, the mail going somewhere else, or having it get lost under a pile of papers, as has happened on my desk. All it pops right there into your news section. It tells you when it was posted. It tells you when you can do your 471. That's your allowable contract date. That's that 28 days. And this is where you can also make some corrections if you want to the form. It lets you in here if you realize you made any mistakes, typing errors, calculation errors, whatever. You can make those changes here. And that is that's the 470 process. Any questions about the form and submitting it and doing it in the EPIC system here? No? All right. Feel free, please do type in any questions you have about the process as we're going through. Now I'm going to go through the rest of the, there aren't any more screenshots because as I said, the 470 is the only form that's in the new system so far. But I can just tell you about the rest of the forms and how they all do work through the rest of the E-rate process. So as I said, you get that receipt letter, which goes right into your EPIC account.
You can use it to make changes, and it will tell you that 28 days that you have to wait until you do your 471. After that 28 days has passed is when you can officially decide who you want to go with. Now, as I said, it could be your current provider, and that's fine. There's no competition. It's just the one game in town, and that's who you go with. But potentially, you will have to do some sort of evaluation. You may have other service providers contact you. There are lots of new companies out there that are getting involved in the process and trying to get into the business, and you may hear from other ones. Some of these companies will contact you and not offer the service you're asking for in the 470. Here at the commission, I regularly receive emails from companies wanting to offer us cell phone service. We don't ever ask for cell phone service on our 471. We just do our basic local long distance 800 numbers. I can ignore those. They did not offer me what I was asking for. Sometimes you'll receive contacts from people who do not provide service in our area. We've had lots of that in the last few years. I think it's getting just a lot more competition out there. Companies are getting really desperate for customers. And I've had many libraries who said, I had a company contact me, and it sounded like a great deal. So I contacted them and said, either I'm in Nebraska, and they said, well, we don't serve Nebraska, or I'm in little so-and-so town in way up in northeast Nebraska, for example. Do you serve us? And they say, no, we've never heard of you. So you may encounter that. You may have to just, weed through all of those. And if they don't serve your area, you just delete them and don't have to worry about them. Yes, question just said, by ignore, do you mean that it's okay to throw these away and not keep those irrelevant bids for all 10 years? Yes, because they did not offer you what you're looking for or asking for. It's not relevant to any of your evaluations. Yeah. And if they, the only reason any of these would come back up is if they want to question, why didn't you pick them as a provider? But they won't ever come back for that because they don't provide your area and they didn't offer you what you're looking for. Yeah. So, yep, anything that isn't actually applicable to what you're doing or where you are, you do not have to evaluate or pay attention to at all. Correct. But if you do have anything that you do have to look at, you do have to have some sort of comparison, some sort of officially open, a fair and open bidding process using cost as the primary factor. Now, that does not mean the most important factor. You wouldn't always go with the cheapest guy in town. That usually doesn't work out well. But if you do have to do some sort of comparison, you do have to do, if you do have multiple companies who are actually offering you something valid, you do have to have some sort of comparison showing why you picked who you picked. This would be just in case USAC comes back and does an audit and wants to know. Or if the company, potentially a new company in town, comes back and says, hey, we said we could offer you this, why didn't you pick us? You have to have something that proves why. This is an example of what you can do to show why you picked who you did. Now, what you do here first is figure out what is important to you when you're picking a service provider. And it can be various things. It doesn't have to be all of these. These are just some examples. Obviously, price has to be on here, and it has to be the most primary factor, meaning worth the most number of points. Not 50%, as you can see here, but just worth more points than everything else. You decide what was important to you and assign points to it. And then when you find vendors who offer it, you give them points in each area. Prior experience with vendor, that would be their current person. Flexible invoicing, will they do discounts or will they do reimbursements? Are they good for the environment? Are they local? Something else you could add is customer service record. Have you heard bad things about them or had bad experience with them yourself, so you don't want to work with them? Or the other way around, you've heard really good things around them, you might want to switch. Put them all on your little chart here. Assign them all points, what you think they're worth, up to 100, and then when you get the bids and hear from these companies, assign them points. In this case, you can see, obviously, some new vendor came into town, really cheapest prices, but you don't know them at all. They earned a certain number of points for anything. In the end, though, vendor number three, they had earned the most points, and they really went over the top here because we know them. We've had experience with them before. So that's why you picked that vendor, even though they weren't the cheapest in town. Even if this company comes back and questions what did you do, why, and makes USAC question you, you have this showing, well, this is why. We did a comparison. We don't know anything about these guys, and that's why they didn't earn the most points. End of discussion. So this is only if you happen to have multiple companies contact you and they offer you what you're actually looking for. You would want to do something like this and just have it on your file somewhere in case you get asked. That's probably one of the more complex things you need to do. One of the most complex things you need to do in E-Rate is this, if it ever comes up. If, as in many towns we have in Nebraska, there is only one company in town that provides the service, you don't have to do this at all. You've only got the one company. That's it. That's who you're going with. This is all irrelevant to you. So after you do that, someone asked, where are we posting these for the bidding process? You mean, where are you posting this evaluation? You don't have to post this anywhere. This is just you're keeping your own record, this in your own records, just in case you get asked. As far as posting what services you're looking for, if that's what you mean, that's what your 470 does. That puts out there what service you're looking for. So that's two different things. I'm not sure what you mean by what you're where you're posting, what it is you're posting. The library posts the 470 and says what they're looking for. Then what will happen is companies may contact you. They may most likely email you or call you and say, or mail you something saying, hey, we are responding to that 470 that you posted and saying we can provide this service. Based on that information they give you, they mail it, they email it or send it to you themselves. Is it in the paper? No. By posting, I mean you're posting your 470 to the E-Rate system. You're submitting your form to the E-Rate system. And it is publicly available to all service providers. They will then contact you. They will send you an email. A company will email you and say, hi, I am so-and-so company, and we saw you asked, you did a 470 for E-Rate purposes, and we want to say we could give you this service. Then you have to look at it and see if it's anything that you can respond to or not. Okay, great. All right. Now, after this is done, if you've had to do that, then you go to the 471. We're getting a little close on our time here. I may run a little over past. Well, we started about 5 minutes late. I was just noticing it's getting close to 3:30, but I'm going to get through the last of these forms, last of my slides here for you guys. So I may run a little late. We might go about 15 minutes over. If you have to leave, please don't worry about it. I am recording this, so you'll have the recording later to watch. I apologize for running a little longer than what I had originally planned for. So after you've done the 470 and waited the 28 days, even if you only have a single provider in town, you still have to wait the 28 days to submit your 471. You still have to give that leeway there, that amount of time. So just do your 470, sit back, wait. Look at that date from that email that got sent to you within the system saying, here's your allowable contract date, and then do your 471. And this is where you say who you've picked, how much it's going to cost, your discount calculation information, all of that information is in here. And this is what I just said after the 28 days. If you have to sign a new contract, that's when you do that as well. Before you do the 470. If it's an ongoing contract with a company, you don't have to sign a new one every year, no. Only if you need to sign a new one. Hopefully we'll hear filing window opening soon, so you'll know that date. When you're doing your 471, each of your applications will be given, each of your services will be assigned a funding request number. It's like a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. When USAC contacts you, they may refer to that number, so you'll notice that on your form. Your service provider has a SPIN number that will be assigned to them that they use for different services. Sometimes they have more than one. If it's your same company you've always used, you'll know the number. You can just submit it, use it on the form. If it's a new company, double check with your provider to make sure that you have the right ID number for whatever they are using it for. You'll get another letter within your news section of your Epic system about the 471 saying we've received it. You can make your changes there if you need to make any error, fix any errors. And that's when you wait. That's when your application goes into review. You've done your 470, you've done your 471, and they check on it. The PIA reviewers will look at anything on the form. They may contact you. to ask for additional information. They will be sending you this contact information within the EPIC system. Whenever you will also be sent an email as well, letting you know something new has been put into the system so that you need to go and look at it. You don't have to keep checking the system every day to see, did they send me something? Did they send me something? You'll be pushed out some emails saying, go over here and check and see what they're asking for. And then you'll know you need to go and log into your EPIC account and see what the question is. Very often these letters that they send you are long and convoluted and written in what I like to call USAC-ese. If you have trouble interpreting them, contact me. That's my job here, is to help you figure out these letters and answer them correctly. I can translate what they're saying to you. Usually they take about 4 pages to say what could be said in like 3 sentences. So if you receive one of these letters, let me know, and if you can't figure it out, and I will help you answer and tell you exactly what you need to do. They used to sometimes copy me when they'd send these information out to you, when they'd send these as emails. I'm not exactly sure what's going to happen in the new system. Will I be copied and know that you've been sent one or not? It wasn't very reliable even before. So, but if you get something and you're not sure what's up with it, let me know. You can send me a copy of it, and I can help you answer the questions. But definitely do answer the questions. They usually give you 14 days to respond. If you don't respond to them, they'll just use what they do know and use that information to approve or disapprove your application. They aren't usually trying to like catch you in some way here when they're sending these questions to try and trip you up and make you not get your money. They want to give you the money, but they want to make sure everything's all the I's are dotted and T's are crossed, so to speak. So they're trying to help you, like saying, so a lot of them say, we think you meant to answer this. Is that what you meant? Because we'll change it for you if you want, to try and get the money to you. Or they want to make sure, where did you get your school lunch numbers from? Where did you get this information from? We just want to clarify. Can we see a copy of a bill to make sure we know what you're asking for, or what you're going to be getting? So they're trying to help you, so don't panic when you get these. Just look at it, see if you can figure it out. If not, send it off to me, and I will make sure you get your questions answered. This is that Program Integrity Assurance People, PIA reviews, will be coming from. Once they're done with all that, asking your questions, verifying what your information is, that's when they issue the funding commitment decision letter. That's what will be sent also to your news section of your EPIC account, and will tell you if you've been funded or not funded. So look at this and see what it says. Did you get all your money? Did you get some of it? Did you get none? They might do more than one of these. They may need to separate out evaluating your Category 1 and your Category 2 separately. So pay attention. Look at what's on the letter. This is the information you use to do your third form in the process, your 486, saying we want our money. This is also where if you are denied, you can appeal. If you want to, there is an appeals process. You've got 60 days to file and say you want to do one. And there's information on the US website about this. Appeals are not a fast process. I'll tell you that right now. I've helped quite a few libraries. A few libraries here in Nebraska do it. It can take a couple of years sometimes to have it go through all of their cert processes. The first you go to USAC and try and appeal. If that doesn't work, you get bump it up to the FCC, and I have done that. As an example, just earlier this year, we received an approval of an appeal for a funding request from funding year 2012. So library had to wait from 2012 till now to get their money because we had to prove that something went wrong in the system, the process, and whatnot. But they got it. So if you feel you want to fight something that's a denial, don't be afraid to, but do understand it's going to take some time for it to go through the whole process. But once you do have your funding commitment letter, you immediately sit down, log into your EPIC, and do your 486. This is where you say, yes, we want your money. Thank you for setting it aside for us. Everything you need to do to complete this is in your funding commitment decision letter. You don't need to pull out any other information or bills or invoices or anything. They've just basically all you're doing is repeating from the commitment letter into the 486 that, yes, we want what you've allotted to us. There is a deadline, 120 days after the service starts, or 120 days after the date of the letter, for those letters that have come after the service, our funding year start in July. End of October is when that falls for. That's the ultimate, last, latest deadline. If I do pay attention to what you guys are doing, I can pull up spreadsheets of your activity and know what forms you have and haven't submitted, and that's also part of my job. If you haven't
if it's getting close to this deadline, I will reach out to you and let you know with a reminder. I usually start looking at these in September to let you know the deadline's coming. And if I send you an email saying 46 is done and you have, according to the records, you haven't done it yet, this is not just a mass email I send out to everybody. I specifically send it just to the people who, according to USAC's database, haven't done this yet. So if you get something like that from me, look at it, pay attention. If you're not sure what I'm talking about, let me know, and I can guide you to submitting what is missing. You'll get another notification letter into your news section from this one as well, saying, yes, thank you, we got your 46. Now, the last couple of forms in the process, this is the invoicing. This is telling E-Rate how you want to get your money. And there's two forms related to this, three, depending on what you're doing. You have a choice of either paying all your bills in full and getting reimbursement afterwards. So you'd pay throughout the year, and at the end of the year, get a reimbursement amount. Or you could have your bills discounted as you pay them throughout the year via from your service provider. If you want a reimbursement after you paid your bills in full, you, as the applicant, file a BARE form, the Billed Entity Applicant Reimbursement Form. That's the 472. If you want a discount on your bills, you just work this out, contact your provider. Sometimes they proactively contact you, which is nice, and tell them you want to do that, and then they submit the service provider invoice form, which they call the SPI, the 474. So once you've gotten through the 46, you always do the first three. At this point, you might do the BARE, or your provider would do the SPI, depending on how you're going to be getting your money. The BARE form also has a deadline of 120 days after the last service date. Also falls at the end of October. I will also send reminders out to that to people who haven't submitted it yet, just making sure you're going to be able to get your money, same as I do with that 486 reminder. Something new. Now, we definitely recommend, if you can, do the service provider invoice one, have them just discount your bills off the bat. Then you don't have to worry about getting money later or submitting any other forms. It's just up to them. And most of our libraries seem to do that pretty successfully. Sometimes, though, your provider can't do it or doesn't want to do that, or for whatever reason things don't work out and you do need to do the reimbursement after the fact, that's when you would be responsible for doing the BARE form. So if you can't do the service provider, have them discount it, you'll do the reimbursement. Something new with reimbursements is that it will now be direct deposit into a library's bank account. Previously, the way the process actually worked was you submitted a BARE, and then USAC sent the money to your provider, and your service provider cut you a check. It went through them as a middleman. That's not really necessary. Once you've decided you just want it directly, they don't really need to be involved, but that's just how it was, the process was. They've changed it to now it's going to go directly from USAC just to you, not involving the provider anymore. This is a huge improvement, let me tell you, because we have had a few providers who are slow on cutting those checks, who get small ones, don't really understand what they're supposed to do. We've had to fight with some of them to get the money to the libraries. It has been a problem. Now it will go directly. It's only direct deposit, electronic bank transfers, no checks issued anymore. This is starting with this funding year 2016, this year right away. The BARE form itself will also only be online. It was up to last year, you could still, and I did help a few libraries, you could still do it in paper and mail it into USAC, but you won't be able to do that anymore. If you do decide to do direct reimbursement, and now with this bank transfer, you're going to have a bank. Need to have a bank account somewhere that this money will go into. Library's account, a library foundation account, whatever works for you. You're also going to have to work out, you may potentially have to think about and work out, where does the money go when it comes into a library's account? When it's direct deposited, does it filter down to the library somehow? Is that reflected on the library's budget somehow? Make sure that where it goes, for example, if it goes into the city's account, that the city realizes that money needs to somehow reflect in the library's budget, or needs to be filtered out to the library as part of their monies. Same thing if it goes into the library's account. So you'll have to think about that if you do end up doing this. In order to do the direct deposit, they've changed around this form that's already existed, the 498, to be able to provide them with your banking info. It says here available in January, but they claimed it is available as of today. I tried to look for it in the Epic this morning when I saw this notice, and I couldn't find it, so I'm not exactly sure. But coming soon, we'll say for now, you'll be able to fill out this info. So if you do want to do
reimbursements, go ahead as soon as this form's available and just get your information in there. You're just going to be submitting your banking info, your account number, routing numbers, all the usual banking info, and then it's there ready for you whenever you do go around, end up submitting a bare form to get your reimbursement. So get this in there ahead of time, have it in there, set aside, done, and then you'll be ready when you're working on bears later on in the year. You will need to have your tax ID number to do this. You should, the library or city should have one for payroll. And something new is called the DUNS number. They're asking for this information as well. It's another code number used to identify people doing business with the FCC, set up by Dun & Bradstreet Business Company. It's free for us because we're using it for a federal form. You can check, and they've got a website to look up, see if your library somehow already has one for some reason, and if not, where you can apply for one. So that will be something you'll have to get a hold of. If you do a bear, you also get a notification letter into your news section of your Epic system for that. But you also get, for no matter which way you're getting your payments, quarterly reports, quarterly disbursement reports. So it will show you what money that USAC has actually sent out. So if you're doing the discounts on your bills where your provider is getting the money from USAC and then discounting the bills to you, you will get a report letting you know how much money USAC has sent to your provider quarterly. Double check that and compare it to your bills to make sure that you're getting the appropriate amount of money you're supposed to be getting. And that is actually the last part of the process for E-Rate. Once you've got that invoicing and your money figured out where it's going, you are done with the E-Rate process. All right, we're a little bit over time, not too bad. Any questions? Anything else you want to add? Any other questions you have about the process? Just got a few other slides here with some information, helpful information, but do you have anything you want to know about the process, anything that was confusing? I'm here, and I will answer anything you want to know. Go ahead and type in your questions section, and I can answer your questions. All right. If you do need help, this is the USAC's customer service department. They call it the Client Service Bureau. Oh, wait. All right. I have a question here. Is the DUNS number for a library, or should this be for the city, assuming the library is a city department? This would be a DUNS number. It should be related to whatever, wherever the bank account is that you want the money to be put into. So it will depend on that. If the library has its own bank account, it would be for that. If it's the city's bank account going in, it would be the city's. So that's going to be the determination of where the DUNS number, who the DUNS number is associated with. And the city might have one for some weird reason that you don't know. Something that's been done in the past that nobody realized related to this. Cool. So this is USAC's customer service. They call it their Client Service Bureau. There's an 800 number that you can call, and you can submit a form online, or you can also now submit questions within the EPIC system. So any questions you have, you can, of course, come to me. That's what I'm here for, as your local person to help you with this. But if I'm not available, you can always go to them, or I may also bump you up to them sometimes for questions that I don't have the ability to answer. Most importantly with this right now is if you try and do that reset password to set up your account in the first place in the new Epic portal and something goes wonky with it, that's who you'd need to contact, and they can get you set up to make sure you've got an account in there. As I said, they tried to get everyone set up with administrator accounts, but we know that some people's did not get set up correctly in the first place. So that's who could get you set up with that. Also, as I mentioned earlier, they have their weekly news briefs. If you're really interested in keeping up with what's going on in E-Rate, I recommend signing up for those. Once a week, get an email, read it. If it's useful to you, save it. Cool. If it'll have your deadlines for things coming up. It will have help articles about how to submit a 470, how to do this on your 471. Information about the basic application process, and then this is a link to our E-Rate website that I set up here at the Library Commission. I have direct links to the school lunch numbers for the Department of Education, I have direct links to that DUNS number search, anything you may need, training information, a whole lot of information specific to Nebraska will be there.
So these are two websites, E-Rate Central and Funds for Learning. They are both considered consultants where you can hire people from there to help you do your E-Rate forms, but they also both have free information for anybody who is doing E-Rate. So if you're looking for more help or guides or instructions or anything, I look at them for a lot of resources as well. You do not have to pay them for some of those training things or just access to their information about the service. And then there's me, the 800 number here at the Library Commission. My email address is there. You can contact me with any questions you have about E-Rate. I am here to guide you through this process, to get you your money, make sure it's hopefully as painless as possible. So anybody have any other questions before we wrap up for this afternoon? Give you a couple of minutes, a couple of seconds here to type anything in you have. Any questions about the process, about your rate in general, about what you can and can't get a discount on? Not seeing anything pop up yet. No? All right. I'm going to say we'll wrap it up for right now then, unless somebody's typing a really, really long, complicated question. please do call or email me if you have anything you want to know afterwards, after the session here. We have recorded it, so I will be letting you know when the recording is available. And the slides and presentation material, I did email to people who pre-registered, and it will be posted also up to the recording page as well, so you have access to all of these slides and screenshots and everything. Other than that, that wraps it up for our E-Rate workshop today. Thank you very much for attending, and good luck. Bye.